Day 12, the 20th of May 2023, we checked out of the hotel after breakfast and headed towards the Basilica of St. Anthony in Padova City. Construction of the basilica probably began around 1232, just 1 year after the death of St. Anthony. It was completed in 1310, although several structural took place between the end of the 14th and the mid-15th century. The saint, according to his will, had been buried in the small church of Santa Maria Mater Domini, probably dating from the late 12th century and near which a convent was founded by him in 1229. St. Anthony was actually a native of Lisbon. He lived between 1195 to 1231. He came to Italy by accident, after his ship was blown off course on its way back to Portugal from Morocco, where he had gone to preach to locals as a Franciscan friar. But once in Italy, he never looked back. Given the baptismal name of Fernando by his parents Martin and Mary Balam, who belonged to one of the most prominent families of the city, at the age of 15, Fernando entered the religious order of St. Augustine. Monastery life was hardly peaceful for the youth, nor conducive to prayer and study, since his old friends came to visit frequently and engaged in vehement political discussions. After 2 years, at his request he was sent to Coimbra, Cornbrough. There he began 9 years of intense study, learning the Augustinian theology that he would later combine with Franciscan vision. The life of the young priest took a crucial turn when the bodies of the first five Franciscan martyrs were returned from Morocco. The Franciscans had been preaching Christ at a mosque in Seville. They were in danger of being martyred at the outset, but the Sultan allowed them to pass on to Morocco, where, after continuing to preach about Christ, despite repeated warnings, they were tortured and beheaded. In the presence of a huge crowd, including the Queen, their remains were carried in solemn procession to the very monastery where Fernando lived. This event, while viewed by many as tragic and sad, was deemed glorious, and in fact was an inspiration to young Fernando, so much so, that it inspired him to make a momentous decision, one that would change his life and the lives of many to come. He decided that he too would become a Franciscan. Many people think of Saint Anthony as the finder of lost items. The reason for invoking Saint Anthony's help in finding lost or stolen items is traced back to an incident in his own life. As the story goes, he had a favorite book of Psalms that was very valuable to him. As this was before the invention of printing, the book was a hand-printed book, but of even more value were his personal notes and the comments he had made in the Psalter to assist with teaching students in the Franciscan order. It was suspected that a novice leaving the community had stolen the Psalter. Anthony prayed for the return of his beloved possession. Shortly after, the novice returned the book and sought Anthony's forgiveness, which in return Anthony forgave him. Novenas to Saint Anthony are celebrated in many churches and shrines around the world. Many begin on Tuesdays, as Tuesday was the day Anthony was buried and the miracles at his tomb began. The beginning of Novenas is linked to a story of a childless couple. After many, many years of longing for a child, the wife took her troubles to Saint Anthony. He is said to have appeared to her in a dream, telling her, for 9 Tuesdays, one after the other, make visits to the Franciscan chapel and approach the holy sacraments of penance and the altar, then pray, and what you ask, you shall obtain. The couple soon had a child. Saint Anthony died in 1231, and was buried in a little church outside the walls of the town of Padua. In 1263, his remains were transferred to the newly constructed basilica. Present at this ceremony was Saint Bonaventure in his role as Minister General of the Friars Minor. When Saint Anthony's coffin was opened in Saint Bonaventure's presence, bones and ashes were found. However, the saint's vocal apparatus was found to be intact, and in particular, his tongue was still red and soft. At the sight of the miracle, Saint Bonaventure exclaimed in awe, "O blessed tongue, that ever praise the Lord, and led others to praise Him. Now it is clear how great are your merits before God."
You see Arab style by the tower, yes. Byzantine by the dome, and a bit of Romanesque and Gothic on the side. But it's nice. This is the nice side. When you approached it from the front, you did not see the beauty of it. Yes. So shall we cross here? Yes. And I can just take you on the main drag of Padova. We have market.
Galileo Galilei taught at the University of Padua, roughly from 1592 to 1610.
That it's the earth that spins around the sun and not the other way around. And he lived here 18 years. So along this road, there are buildings that are faculty of the university. Nowadays, we have 67,000 students on a population of 210,000, which is a lot. It's like a fourth of the city is just young people. So straight ahead, we could go to the city center. I'm just taking you to the main drag and trying to use the portico so you don't get wet. All right? So watch out. encircling the city of Padova. So medieval Padova is inside the walls. Now we're going to cross this street and enter the main drag of Padova. And on the main drag, we will see a house. Probably you saw it from the far, that has a tower. This is the last tower home of Padova, and it dates 1300. This is the metro. This is the tram coming.
We then traveled from Padua to Venice, which was about 46 kilometers and was about a 40 minutes drive to reach the ferry harbor. Venice, the city of canals, is the capital of the region of Veneto and of the province of Venice in Italy. It comprises of a group of 118 islands, many of them linked by 400 bridges and blue-green canals to facilitate the endless traffic. Located in the Venetian Lagoon, a large inlet on the Adriatic Sea, Venice was founded in 421 AD. From 1000 AD to about 1630 AD, it was a powerful maritime empire controlling the spice trade and ruled by dukes, or doges as they were called locally. The city's incredible wealth found expression in gilded palaces and merchant villas lining the main thoroughfare, the Grand Canal. The personal wealth of the powerful enabled them to commission works from the finest Italian and foreign artists for the decoration of their palazzos, guild halls and churches. It is the legacy of this civil munificence which attracts art lovers today. The Basilica di Santa Maria della Salute. It was completed in 1687 and it was built to celebrate the end of the plague. In 1630, Venice experienced an unusually devastating outbreak of the plague. As a votive offering for the city's deliverance from the pestilence, the Republic of Venice vowed to build and dedicate a church to Our Lady of Health.
Okay, so we are crossing a bridge, so it means that we are passing from one island to another. Venice is composed of islands. We have 120 small islands connected by 470 arched bridges. So here in Venice you can go either by boat or on foot, not by car, thank God. Children can ride any bicycle, but they can learn how to row a boat, and rowing is our main sport. And everything is taken by boat because we have ambulance boat, policeman boat, fireman boat, funerals and weddings are taken by boat, and then we have the gondola, our typical Venetian boat, because it can pass everywhere, also where the water is very shallow.
We have 160 small canals, natural canals, from 1 to 2 meters deep. Then there is the Grand Canal, 4 to 5 meters deep. And in front of you, there was the ancient port of Venice, also Marco Polo left from there, 14, 15 meters deep. So depending on high tide and low tide, okay?
The lagoon has a lighthouse, but it collapsed completely in 92 without damaging any of the building around. We just sat on itself. It was built in the same place, in the same shape, but light. There is an elevator if you want to go up. And this is the clock tower, you see. But golden, because this is the newest building we have in the square. It was built in 92. The Renaissance is built in
St. Mark's Basilica. The multi-domed church on St. Mark's Square is a top attraction in Venice and one of Italy's most spectacular cathedrals. It was initially designed to function as a private chapel for the Doge. It was constructed back in the 9th century and was built to house the remains of St. Mark's corpse that was smuggled in from Egypt by Venetian merchants. The building was initially torched to the ground and eventually rebuilt to become an extraordinary structure that is admired by the world to date. The structure is currently made of layers of white marble that were bought from the Middle East. The building has various elements from Byzantine architecture that make it remarkably exquisite. The place is famous for having a Greek cross layout and for using an immense amount of gold in each of its attractions, and because of this, the structure is often called the Church of Gold. St. Mark's Square was initially laid out as a small square lined with a number of trees and plenty of open space around. What's more, it was constructed in front of the original St. Mark's Basilica, which used to be a small chapel within the Doge's Palace. Then we visited the centuries-old Art of Glassblowing factory on Murano Island, home to the world's finest artisan glass. We watched the master craftsman shape molten glass through a combination of heat, blowing and sculptural techniques. We then visited the factory showroom to see beautiful finished works of art.
Saint-Marc Square, it's the Saint-Marc Square. It's the largest square we have in Venice. All the other squares are smaller and nowadays we have glass factories, restaurants, insurance offices and museums, okay? And on the ground floor many school shops and coffee shops. The most famous coffee shop is the one in the church on your back. It's called Cafe Florian and also now has decoration of the 1700, very expensive. You saw the bell tower right here.
Everybody. Lady there, take a seat there. Okay, man. Welcome in our factory. Mr. David is our manager. You can switch off the light, please.
You're not.
Okay, now David is going to show you how we make our glass in there. 1000 is the temperature that you open. Composition of the glass are three elements: sand, soda. As you can see, the master uses an iron file to blow the glass, tweezers and scissors to shape the glass. Remember, this is completely handmade. No school to become a master, because this is a familiar work from father to son. 10 years, this is the time to become a master. It's very, 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 very difficult to become a master. Nowadays, we don't have enough masters to export in all over the world. If some of you want to buy original, genuine Murano glass, need to come here. Otherwise, you can buy a beautiful imitation. Pay attention. In this case, Mr. David is going to show you how we make out a flower vase, flower vase. This is the famous blowing technique. Remember that it's possible to work the glass just when the glass is warm, temperature cool down very quickly, so the master needs to hit the piece minimum 3 times. It's And when the piece is finished, we need 24 hours for the cooling process in another oven. Otherwise, the piece will explode. Look like simple, believe me, this is very, very difficult to do.
Wow!
And now the master ate the piece 1 second, then he will finish the piece. Send, so, remember that you are allowed to take photo film just here, okay? When you go inside, please close everything. Thank you very much. And now the master, he will make the angle of the vase, or I don't know, maybe he's going to show you how we make an animal over. I don't know. Have a look, because this is something that you need. Now, he's going to show you how we make an animal. Over the vase, the master, he will make an animal. Very easy, no?
No.
Looks good.
So nice.
As I told you, 24 hours for the cooling process. Davide, very good. Thank you very much. Yes, this is the reason why we need 24 hours. Thank you. Thank you very much. And now please follow me.
A gandola is a traditional narrow and long Venetian rowing boat. The boat is steered by one person called a gandolier with the help of one oar. Although gandolas were the main means of transport in Venice centuries ago, today it carries tourists from one point of the city to the other. San Giorgio Maggiore is a 16th century Benedictine church on the island of the same name in Venice, northern Italy, designed by Andrea Palladio, and built between 1566 and 1610. The first church on the island was built about 790, and in 982 the island was given to the Benedictine order by the Doge Tribuno Memo. The Benedictines founded a monastery there, but in 1223 all the buildings on the island were destroyed by an earthquake. Then from Venice we headed to Engelberg in Switzerland, which was around 509 kilometers and took us around 5 hours and 50 minutes.